Hello again. Now that you are hopefully ready to start generating those exciting ideas, let me share with you a specific way to go about that. As I mentioned earlier, there are a lot of creativity methods, but we will talk about just one here. Today, I'm going to talk about a method called analogy. This method is all about discovery. Somewhere in the world, there are a few clues that, once put together, will help you tackle the challenge you're engaged with. I'll tell you how it works. There are two important things to consider when trying to discover analogies. One is the challenge you're trying to tackle. The other is the place, the things, from where an inspiration to address your challenge will come from. The challenge to be tackled is the target. The origin of your inspiration is the source. So basically, you want to find inspiration for your ideas by searching for a useful source or sources that somehow share some resemblance with your target. Let me give you an example. Imagine you want to find inspiration to design a new racing swimsuit with low drag that allows you to swim faster. Then you may ask, what sort of things move fast in the water and where can I find it? The ocean might be a good starting place to look for such a thing, as I bet there are a bunch of sea creatures that move really fast. This was exactly what some people thought a while ago when they studied the skin of fast-swimming sharks and found out that the skin was not smooth, but bumpy. And the result? Well, some of the most successful companies that produce swimsuits replicate this skin structure on the surface of swimsuits. So you see, the aim to develop a new and faster swimsuit relates to your targets, and the shark, and more specifically its skin, is your source. Well, you might be thinking, okay, but why should I use this method? That is simple. There is no point in ignoring what's out there in the world or the memories you have in your head about things you have seen and done. So why not check if your problem or parts of your problem have, to some extent, been already solved? Now, you'll not find a clear set of instructions in your source on how you can use it for your designs. The challenge for you is to find a suitable source and in that source identify which parts, which properties and qualities might be useful for you to design your targets. Nature is not the only place to look for sources, but it is a very popular one because if you think about it, most organisms have had many millions of years to evolve and adapt to their environments. However, as you can imagine, sharks are not going to tell you what's about their skin that makes them fast. Now that you have a general idea about how analogies are made, let's have a look at some of the more specific steps you might take to establish a link between a source and a target. So, I'm assuming you have defined your problem. You need to have an idea about what you're trying to achieve, what effect you're trying to bring about. For instance, are you trying to somehow encourage people to slow down and take time to do something properly? Or maybe to prioritize some of their morning rituals? What is the action, the activity you want to support, to reinvent? What is your target? If you have an idea about your challenge, you can start trying to establish analogies between useful sources and your target. Basically, this process entails the search for a source or sources, the identification of a relationship between things within the source that you think share some resemblance to what you're trying to design. Then you have to abstract from what you see and look for the essence of that relationship and not simply copy-paste parts of the source. Finally, you have to transform and transfer it to your target. Easy, hmm? Let's go through another example that illustrates this process. A while ago, a student had in mind to design a better bicycle helmet after suffering from an accident that sent him to the hospital. Although he had already in mind that he was going to try to improve existing helmets, he was ultimately trying to rethink this relationship of protectiveness between his head and the hard surface. Therefore, he searched for inspiration in different places until he found out that woodpeckers have several anatomic adaptations that prevent them from suffering brain damage despite their frequent high-speed hand banging. The student found out that, unlike most birds, the woodpecker's skull is separate from the beak by a flexible spongy cartilage, which works as a shock absorber. He then identified this feature, this relationship of protectiveness between skull and beak, and tried to recreate this spongy layer. However, he had to abstract from the idea of the real spongy cartilage and think about what could be artificially recreated. So, finally, he had to transform this relationship of protectiveness into something to absorb a shock between a person's head and the floor. It turns out that, after many attempts, the student found a special type of dual-density cardboard which enabled him to build a strong, lightweight, and easily producible internal construction, which is finally transferred to the new helmet design. Yet, the student did not directly copy any of the bones in the bird's skull. The clue was in the relation between the skull and the beak of the bird. While this method is, in principle, quite straightforward to implement, there are a few issues you should be aware of. People studying analogies have found out that the chances of designing more novel ideas is higher when you go outside the domain of your problem. So when that student that I mentioned was designing a new helmet, for instance, he explored a domain that was at first sight had nothing to do with the initial problem. But instead of limiting himself to search for existing helmets available in the market or other types of protective gear. However, this search for sources in far distant domains will be challenging because the thing you're trying to look for might not be so evident at the surface level, but instead it could be hiding deep inside the source. One of the main advantages of using analogies is that it can help you to design things from scratch. It encourages you to go out of your comfort zone. It requires you to entertain the idea that if you're curious and spend some time learning about other fields, you might find unexpected connections to your problem. But you cannot forget that your search for a useful source depends on a clear definition of your problem and design challenge. Otherwise, it becomes very difficult to have an idea about what might be useful for solving your problem. To sum up, analogies entail a process we are quite used to because if you think about it, we spend a lot of time comparing things to each other. Your aim is to establish a comparison between what you might be trying to design, what effect you want to realize, and an existing thing or process that already does that in a completely different context, but which, with some transformation, might inspire you to solve your problem. In line with the aim of diverging onto several ideas, don't just stick to the first useful source you come across, but go through the process a few times and explore a number of useful sources. Lastly, the purpose of this method is to generate ideas, so you'll need to start thinking about also narrowing your solution search and maybe cluster, select, and eliminate ideas. Good luck!